Imagine that you are an ancient merchant, right? And you sell things, you buy things, you figure out how much certain things are worth. And a lot of times, they use a set of scales like this, balancing down to figure out how much something was worth, okay? So, I haven't done any strong research on this, but I believe this is what algebra has to do. Physical stuff, they tend to get a little complicated. Instead of physically doing something with stuff, we represent it with symbols and manipulate those symbols. But first, let's look at the analogy. Let's see what it looked like to be one of these ancient merchants and manipulate these objects on the scale. And what manipulating these objects on the scale and keeping it balanced would require us to do. Okay, so let's just imagine, it's not a perfect analogy, but let's imagine we have this bag.
That's pretty legit.
And let's color it in.
Goodness.
Everything is black.
Okay. And here, let's get a little shading in there.
Artistic.
And then, okay. So here we have this bag of stuff. We can move around.
That's a really good bag. I know.
All right, so let's imagine that in this bag is like some coins, some gold coins. Maybe oversimplifying reality, like the actual history of scales and things, but it certainly works for us to understand some algebraic equations. So let's say I have one bag on this side. Now I need some coins. So let's draw some coins. Let's see. No, this is not a sign. This would be a circle. Okay, so there's a coin. Okay, I can't see in the bag. Imagine the bag itself is weightless. Okay, we have to use our imaginations there. How many coins are in the bag?
You don't know.
X.
You don't know.
One.
Why one?
Because it equals out.
Yeah, it equals out, as long as it's balanced, which we're assuming it is. In this case, we can see that the weight over here is equal to the weight over there, and so the stuff hidden there in that mystery bag must be worth one. Yeah?
Never mind. I was going to say, like, what about the weight of the bag, but I remember.
Yeah, I said, let's pretend like it's weightless.
So it's, like, simplified in, like, two functions that, like, when you have a function and then it has, like, the equal sign that equals like another
weight
you have a certain x.
So this represents x, yeah?
Yeah.
And this represents like numbers.
Sure.
The number one. Does that agree with what you were saying?
Well, kind of, but yeah.
Okay.
Write that x equals number one.
X equals the number one. X is equal to one something. One gold coin in this case. So when you see x equals one, you could imagine one in, you know, mystery bag is equal to one gold coin. That's kind of all. Just an analogy here, okay? How about now? How much is X worth now? How much is that bag worth now? Okay. How about,
hold on, give me another minute here.
All right, so now it's not so easy as, it's pretty simple, but it's not so easy as to say, oh, there's the bag, there's some stuff, it must be equal to stuff, right? A bag plus two gold coins is equal to six gold coins.
So the bag would be equal to four.
The bag would have to be equal to four. Now, how did you come by that?
Well, because six minus the two would equal the bag.
I want just the bag.
Right.
So I minus, right?
Right.
We're already doing things that students resist doing in equations when we're looking at a physical thing. Let's take two away from both sides. Now, why did I take two away from both of them?
Cancel.
What's that?
You can take one away from, or you can take two away from one without taking two away from
Yeah, if I go back to this and I take away these two, now I don't have the programming abilities to make this scale actually move, but we know that, what would be happening? But what would be happening?
That would be lowering.
This side would be going down. So in order to stop that from happening, I take two more off of that side. I take away equal parts from both sides. Okay?
Jack, you know, grab this thing. This is,
sorry, just keep somebody.
Oh,
that's the wrong one. Oh, gosh.
No, that's transitivity. Yeah. Here we go. Oh. Damage this fine piece of furniture. Excuse me.
Common notion number three. That would be from a book called The Elements. That big, thick, the thickest book you see up there on my little CD rack of books.
Read it?
No.
No.
I read some of it. Common notion number three. So he sets out to prove lots of things about stuff, about geometry, really, mostly. It does some algebra, sort of, using lengths and areas and stuff. So this says, if equals are subtracted from equals, then the remainders are equal. Does that make sense?
No.
We just did that.
Yeah. Oh, that makes
equals. Both sides are equal. Equals were subtracted, two from both sides. What's left? Two things that are equal to each other.
Equals.
You got it.
If equals are subtracted by equals, they're equals.
What?
If equals are subtracted by equals, they're all.
Equals are subtracted from equals.
Just like that. If equals are subtracted from equals, then. Let's see. If equals are subtracted from equals, then the remainders are equal. That's what we just did. If equals are added to equals, then the remainders are equal. Right? Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so basics. Starting with the basics of an algebraic equation, what, using algebraic symbols, how can I represent this situation symbolically?
2 plus x equals 3.
2 plus mystery equals what?
Or 6.
6.
So.
Okay. Now, would it be difficult to have scales sitting in front of you to take two coins from this side and two coins from this side and set them aside?
No.
No, it would not be very difficult. Would it get difficult? Could it get messy? Could it get very busy and crowded?
Yeah.
So you can see why someone in the past may have invented some algebra so that we can write these things down. Like I can look at or imagine or state the initial conditions, like what would be on either side of the scale. And then manipulate the symbols to get what the bag is worth, rather than actually having to move stuff around physically. Okay? Now, right now is the time that I make a brief but emphatic plea to all of you. Okay? If I take this equation, let's just get a new page going. Can you just see what the answer is?
Yeah.
Absolutely, you can just see what the answer is. Why?
It's
very simple. It's a very simple equation. I know my addition. I know 2 plus 4 is 6. It doesn't take my brain very long to say, well, I got to add something that's 6, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 4. It must be 4. Right? Now, in the past, maybe someone has said to you, wow, I don't know how you do that. I don't know how you just see the answer. Okay? The answer to why you can just see what x is that equation is very, very simple. Okay? And it didn't take you long to probably, at your most advanced guess and check. Even if I made this equation a little more complicated, you could guess and guess and guess and guess, say, well, that's too big, that's too small. You know, narrow it down, that there. That's the number that works, okay? Now that's not insignificant. It's not insignificant to know that what I need is a number that makes this equation true. That's important. But just see it, algebra is not a good algebra, okay? It's a good start. It's not a good long-term plan, okay? But many algebra students treat it like it is a good long-term plan. It really, really isn't, okay? So, please, if you are a guess and checker, or I just see it and I don't know how to show you and all that kind of stuff, please give that up. because I know who you are, not who does that, but you are a person who can, you know, if the equation's simple enough, you just can say, oh, this must be X, and you amaze your friends and family, and it looks like you're doing complicated things, but you're really just maybe a fast guesser or a checker. And when it comes to this equation, who's that good at guess and checker?
You.
Pretty good.
No.
Oh.
Absolutely not. I used to be a, I just the algebraist until I realized there's no guessing and no amount of guessing and checking, not no time long enough for me to guess exactly the right answer. Right? To try and make this point, I want you to take a minute or two and try and guess what x would have to be to make this equation true. Okay?
Okay.
So try some x's. See if you can figure it out. See if you can find an x value that works. Huh? You can write that. You can use your calculator. One thing you should know is that if you put 2 here, 2 has to go here. You can't put 2 here and 5 here. Right? That's something that's lost on some people. So that's all right. If you're still passionate about finding it, it's commendable. I appreciate your passion. But I do have to, we have to continue. Well, I can tell you now, it's not a whole number. It's not an integer. It's not like 5 or negative 2 or something easy like that. That would have been too easy. It's not even a decimal. Like it's not like 1.27. It's an infinite decimal. It's like 1.27351. And forever and ever and never repeating and never stopping.
Like pi.
Like pi. It's not pi, but it's like pi.
Let me give you a cool thing. What it is.
There's actually two.
How did you figure
even
out?
If you found one, there's another one. There's two of them.
How did you figure out something? You will know
by the end of this year.
Okay, because okay. I was just like,
it's not reasonable for me to expect that you would be able to find this with your current level of experience.
Of course.
That's why we're starting here. It all starts with this.
Yes.
Okay? Now, the solution, one of the solutions, negative 2 plus the square root of 84 divided by 2.
So much confusion.
That's one of the answers?
That's one of the answers. Here's the other answer. Negative 2 minus the square root of 84 over 2.
Why can't you just do the actual answer to the square root of 84?
Actual answer to the
whatever square root of 84 is.
Yeah.
Why can't you just do that?
Well, how do I find the square root of 84?
Put
it in the calculator?
No.
How do I find her?
Oh, yeah, you can.
You haven't seen that.
He's put that up like 400 times.
Square of 84.
It's 401.
Well, it gets to this 9. What's that 9 right there? It's just the rounded answer of, you know, based on whatever the next digit is. There's an infinite number of digits after this, right? I can never finish writing down the decimal that represents the square root of 84. It's what's called an irrational number. So I can't just write it down.
Okay.
Okay? If I take this and I plug it in for x, either here or whatever version of the equation I want to plug it into, it will work. If I plug it in here on this side, I'll get 17, on this side I'll get 17. If I plug it in here, I'll get 20 on this side, 20 on this side. It will work. Both of these will work. Both of these will give you that either 17 or 20 or whatever. Yeah.
How do you multiply by an irrational decimal?
These are all things that we'll have to cover later. Right? They're great questions, and I'd love to just sit down and answer them. I mean, it'd be kind of meaningless until we have a little more experience with solving equations. We won't really care about this until we want to solve an equation that this is a part of. Right. So, my little plea here is, please, don't stay in the ways of saying, I can just see that this is 4, and I don't know how to show you that. I don't know how to show you what that I came up with that answer. It starts really simply. It starts right here. Right. With this kind of an idea. Some bag of stuff plus 2 things that I can see is equal to 6 things that I can see. Okay? That are not mysteries, that are not hidden behind some X or Y or whatever. And if I take two away from this side and two away from this side, by taking away two from both sides, I subtracted equals from equals and the remainders are equal, right? Common notion number three over there. And I've left it so that the mystery unknown amount is clearly four, right? Because both sides are balanced. And that's what an equation is. And in equation form, how do I take two coins from this side and two coins from this side?
Minus
two. Minus two and minus two. X is four. At two, X, six minus two is four. Start there. Now, it may seem, well, silly, right, to subtract two from both sides of this equation. But it starts there. It starts there, and we build on it, and we build on it, and we build on it. We improve, and we increase our knowledge. And we're able to handle more and more complicated equations with one step, two steps, three steps, until we get to the point where it's just, well, there's so many steps, let's call it multi-step. There's lots of steps to follow, okay? And not a prescribed number of steps, like, here's what you always do. Step number one, step number two, step number three. It's just the idea of trying to get that mystery amount all by itself, one of them, all by itself, on one side, okay? Let's start off nice and easy, okay? Pre-made some of these guys. Here we go. Like that. So I pre-made some stuff that we can mess around with. I'm going to put some stuff over there and some stuff over here, and I just want you to imagine that you are manipulating these things, okay, and see if you can figure out what one of these bags is worth. So now, whether you write this as an equation or you just kind of imagine that you're moving stuff around, that's fine. If you want to draw a picture of it, they do that. Okay, and then I will, with you, move stuff around on both sides. Okay. So remember to keep both sides balanced. Don't let them get out of whack.
Well, I basically I saw 8 on that side, so I took 8 down. I took 8 on.
Good. Okay. Let's take these 8 off of here. Well, now it's all out of whack, right? So we're gonna take 8 of these.
Yeah. And
now it's coming back. It's balanced again.
Yeah. And now it's since there's 10 coins left and there's 2 bags. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So 10 coins.
Okay. So. So you said to yourself, this is a bag, and this is a bag, this is a bag, and this is everything else on this side, so this must be the same as a bag, right? The same as that second bag.
Yeah.
Makes sense, doesn't it?
Good job, Alan.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like compliments.
Let's not compliment.
Thank you.
That would be terrible.
Thank you for not complimenting.
All right, now. Does that make sense or not make sense?
No, it doesn't.
Pretty great.
Yeah, that was. No, how would you write that?
Oh, okay. Well, we'll deal with that. I mean, we would do a little more. We wouldn't simply say like, oh, I see.
Oh.
You do want to get one bag on one side by itself.
If you're living with one bag on the left and one bag on the right, then you have 10.
Should that work?
Yeah.
If I take this bag off, is it balanced?
No,
but if I take this bag as well, should that put it back to square?
Yeah.
Should.
Yeah.
So took that bag. One bag is one bag, right?
Right.
Take the bag off of both sides. It shouldn't throw off the balance of the scale. Now I can see a bag, 10 points, equal to each other. A bag is worth 10 points.
Yeah.
So like, that's all of those points on the right scale. Is that 10 or is it
Yes, 10, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 coins.
But, so it would be 20 at this session.
What?
What? I am sorry.
Right now there's 20 on both sides?
No, like if there was
added.
A bag on that side.
Uh-huh.
And then there was another bag on that side.
You're right.
There'd be 20 coins on each side.
There are 20 coins on each side. But the question is, what's one bag worth?
Now.
Yes, there are 20 coins on both sides.
That's what that was.
There are 20 coins on both sides. Because there's 10 in here and 10 in here. There's 10 here and there's 10 in here.
Oh,
yes. Okay? Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that was a bit of a tricky one. Let's maybe make it a little simpler. Let's do another one.
That one.
That's cool.
I
put those up there. It's convenient.
Let's just go with it. Tell me that, don't shout it out. Take a second. Figure out how much one bag is worth.
Is how I got it, but I think
that's can you show me? Then we'll just transition over to an equation.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you take you subtract 9 coins.
So I'll take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 from this side.
Then you take 9 from the other side.
Okay, 2, 4, 6, 8, and 9.
And then there's an even number, there's 2 bags, so you split the coins into 2.
Yeah.
There's 2 bags.
I observe that there's 2 groups of bags, 2 groups of 1 bag, right? So then I would need to group these the same way to be able to see what 1 bag must be worth. If there's 2 bags over there and 2 groups of 2 over here, then in one of those groups I should find what's the same as 1 bag.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But when I take 4 and I put it into 2 groups of 2, or I break it into 2 groups, what is that called when I take a group and I break it into smaller groups?
Dividing.
What do we just do to both sides of this scale?
Subtract.
We did, but what, just now. We divided both sides by
2.
Okay? Let's look at an equation. Let's back it up. Let's look at what this looked like originally. What did this look like originally? Well, now how will I symbolically represent a bag? An X. That's an X, that's an X. There are 2 times X's, right? If 1X weighs X, then 2 times them weighs twice as much. Yes?
Could you do X squared?
Oh.
Okay.
That's X times X.
No.
It would be hard to show you what, I don't even know how to explain to you how X times X would look like if X is a bag. If X is a bag of coins, how do I multiply that by another bag of coins? That's hard.
Like, I don't even know.
I don't know.
Like 2 bags.
I would have to take all the coins out of 1 bag, count them, and then take this bag and multiply it by that number of coins. So like, it's just too much. It's too weird.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not x squared, it's x and another x, right? If I look at it as x and another x, and I'm adding these x's, I collect like terms, I have 2x. I have 2 times a bag. I have a bag 2 times. 2 groups of a bag. I'm saying a lot of different ways. Plus some more stuff. Plus what?
Nothing.
Plus 9. 9 coins on this side.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, equals what on this side?
13.
Okay, so the first thing we did was to just get these coins out of here, right? I only care about the bags.
Minus 9.
So that's minusing 9, so that's a minus 9.
And then we just cross it off.
Take away 9. 9 minus 9, 9 coins minus 9 coins?
0.
0 coins. 2x is equal to 4. 13 minus 9 is 4. And then what we do, we group these into two groups, because there's two groups of a bag here, and we're going to see, like, what would, if I broke these into two groups as well, what would be in each group? So what do? We divided both sides by 2. And x must be, what is inside that bag must be 2. That equal sign means both sides are flat, level, balanced with each other. And everything we do is to make sure we don't upset that balance. If you wanted to, for a while, draw like a set of scales and put bags and coins on, it'd be exactly what this equation represents, 2x plus 9 equals 13. And without realizing it, we've just kind of gone beyond ourselves, beyond the level that I want us to be at the moment. We've done a two-step equation. We subtracted from both sides, and we divided on both sides. When we look at a scale, it's a little easier to see.
So how would you do it to, like, to the second on a scale?
Oh, x squared? This is an analogy, and at some point, analogies are not perfect, and we say they break down, that's where it breaks down.
All right.
Say squared. I would have to use something other than a bag, I think. Okay. You're welcome. Here, let's start. Let's see if we go simple. Smaller, so I can represent it with an equation. To the side. Okay, so I'm going to set up some, what I think is fairly simple. Alright, there's a bag there. There's a. Oh, no. There we go. Okay. Imagine that you're sitting in front of a set of scales. Like, I have a set of scales over here, actually. Right here. And it wobbles back and forth. But right now, if I try to be still, it's balanced. So what do we know about what's inside here?
They're equal.
I don't know how much they are, but I do know they must be equal. If I take one from this side, it's not balanced anymore. I need to take the same on the other side so that I don't upset the balance. Right? If I put one over here, now it's heavier, I need to put one over here too to balance it out. That's all it is. That's all algebra is. Now, can an ancient merchant with a set of scales figure out the solution to that equation I gave you earlier, x squared plus 2x minus 3 equals 17?
Probably not. Merchant.
Huh?
Well, considering he's a merchant, back then merchants didn't know advanced math.
Well, merchants were the mathematicians of the day. They were the ones that needed to use number manipulation more than anybody.
Well, I
didn't. Have you guys heard of the Fibonacci numbers?
No.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah.
Wait,
what?
The Fibonacci numbers?
Yeah.
I won't bother you with what they are exactly, but they were thought of by this guy named Fibonacci? No, not really. His name was Leonardo of Pisa.
Leonardo
da Vinci.
I know. No,
I'm going to start timing this. He brought Arabic numerals to the Western world. So what's the Western world?
Europe. North America.
We're in the Western world.
This
is before America. This is in the 1400s, early 1400s.
Africa.
So Europe,
Western,
right?
Right.
Okay. He brought it from the East, okay? From Asia. Okay, let's just call it Asia.
How do you know this?
So how do we know this? Our research. See if I'm wrong. So he brought Arabic numerals. What are Arabic numerals?
Roman numerals.
They're Arabic. They're not Roman.
They're the ones we use.
Roman rules. Right? Wait. Hey. What's going on? Just chill out. The ones that we use, like 10, 11, 12, things like that. Before that, they had Roman numerals. If you try to do arithmetic with Roman numerals, it is ridiculous. Just to write the number a million is also ridiculous. Okay? So, he brought Arabic numerals, and my point here is, he was traveling the world and working with numbers because his dad was a merchant. He was buying and selling and trading throughout the world, as it was known at the time. He traveled along with his dad and brought Arabic. He had, it just seems the funniest thing to me. I mean, imagine using Arabic numerals, the numbers we use, right?
Yeah.
Fairly simple system. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Once I run into symbols there, I move over to the next position, and that's a 1. That 1 and a 0 means 10 of these 1s, right?
Yeah.
And I go through, I cycle through all the symbols in the tens position, okay? I got up to 9 and a 9, and I add 1 more. Well, that's 2. I don't have enough symbols for that. I move over here. Well, that's too many symbols, so I move over to the next position, 1, 0, 0. That means 100 of these 1s, right? The Roman numeral system, if you know anything about Roman numerals and how they represent numbers, trying to do arithmetic with them would be really hard.
I thought a million was like
especially if you don't actually know all the...
M is, a million is M 1,000 times.
Oh.
You have to write M 1,000 times to write a million. How do you do with Arabic numerals? 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1 million. Easy. And he had to be, like, he had to talk people into this. She's like, no, actually Roman numerals are not very great. Arabic numerals are where it's at, okay? They're the new hotness. And he tries to tell them how great they are, and he gets people like saying, no, these are, you don't want to use these.
Weird thing.
M to the M?
Yeah.
They didn't have power. Like,
no.
They didn't have exponents. It was really weak. It was really weak sauce. Anyway, what I'm saying is, merchants in the ancient days drove mathematics. They had a real need for mathematics. Now that we can represent symbolically, we can do much more advanced things than they were able to do. All right. So, we're going to figure out what this bag is worth. We're merchants in the ancient days. How do we isolate one bag? Yeah?
So, you subtract 6, like all from the left side.
Take all of the coins away from this side. Of course you would. Right? You would want to leave one bag by itself.
And then you take 6 from the other side.
Yeah.
And then 4 in the bag, and then 4.
There must be 4 in this bag if it weighs as much as these 4 coins, assuming that the bag is weightless, of course. We're,
yeah.
We're pretending that.
It's like.
That's a 1-step equation. A simple 1-step. The 1-step was? What? What was the 1-step? Taking 6 of the coins off on each side, yeah? As an equation, we'd have x plus 6, a bag, plus 6 coins, is equal to, how much was over there?
8.
8?
No, it was 10.
Sorry. 10 coins?
12.
I would imagine so.
No, because...
So we took 6 off of this side and 6 off of this side, because we don't want to throw this thing off balance. And x is 4. Simple one-step equation. When you see this, I want you to start off just like imagining, like, okay, so this is a thing. I just don't know how much it's worth. This is 6 things. It could easily be 6 coins or 6 tennis shoes or 6 puppy dogs or whatever.
Oh, puppies.
Okay. Equals 10 gold coins. Okay. It's just a simple analogy. And if I wanted to remove all of the excess stuff so that I'm just left with one bag, then... Well, that's what I want to do. And if, when you look at a picture of it, it becomes a lot more clear. Like, let's just, like, clean house. Let's just get the stuff that's cluttering up this side off of that side so that one bag is left by itself, and we'll know what one bag is worth. Okay? In this case, one bag is worth 4 coins. Okay? Let's do And now let's see what happens. Yeah.
want to try? Okay, take all these off of there. Of course, it's unbalanced right now.
Yeah, so I'm going to take that much off of that side.
Okay.
And so there's four coins.
Yep.
But nothing on the right side.
Yeah.
So like the bag has to be like negative four.
Whoa.
Yeah, I got
whoa.
That too. I actually did. I wrote it down.
Negative four. So we've invented negative numbers now. How could this happen? I mean, in the physical world, how would this happen?
It's not.
It's
yeah, this bag would have to float away.
It's
filled with helium.
Okay. This bag would have to float away. That's not possible.
Well, the bag could be zero.
Even if it were zero, then we'd have four coins on this side and nothing on this side, and this side would not be balanced.
So negative four.
So it has to be negative
four. Oh, but it can be negative four.
Not physically, but mathematically,
yeah.
It could be. And even in the real world, if we were exchanging money and I gave you negative four.
Oh,
I know. What would I give you negative four?
No, I was going to say inside the bag could be taxes.
you're getting on the right track.
No,
yeah.
Like you're in debt.
You're in debt. How do I give you negative four?
It means you owe that person. Yeah, it means you have to give something to get.
It's an IOU.
It's a negative.
It means you have to give something to get nothing.
Right?
You could like borrow like $4
from these are $20 million.
Wait, hold on. I can give you four, which means I've given you four. Like four has left my hand and gone to you. How do I give you negative four? Hint, it's not good for you. I give you negative four.
Take
I actually take four from you. That's what negative means. Or if you don't have any, I say, you owe me $4. That's what me giving you negative $4. You having negative $4 means you owe me four. Means you owe me taxes.
Pardon me.
It's negative money.
That's like having negative $4.
I see
like
my elbow.
Having $4 in your wallet. Because let's say I've got $2 in my wallet. I owe me $1. I can't use it.
If you have $2 and you owe Alan $2, you have $0.
Yes.
If you have $2 and you owe Alan $6.
I have negative four. I have
negative $4. You don't have enough to pay him back.
There's a deadline, Zach.
Otherwise, you're going to use that.
Okay, let's go again. Right? We have invented negative numbers now.
I like this. This is fun to me.
Before I have to start timing this. The number of coins divided by the number of bags.
Yes.
Six.
Six.
I have that.
Okay. Let's look at an equation. 3x equals how many coins do we have over here?
18.
18 coins. We count them all up. We got 18. We count them by two. Though. Okay. What we've done is divide both sides by three. Let me show you what that looks like. Just come over here. Remember when we first learned about dividing? Like in third grade? Second grade? I don't know.
I think it was
division
second.
In third grade.
Yeah.
Fourth.
Yeah, I learned
division
in
second.
Okay.
Sixth grade.
So
you learned division. Well, you learned multiplication was like 2 times 3 is 2 groups of 3.
Oh, I know that.
Or 3 times 2 is 3 groups of 2. Well, division is just the opposite. It's taking the whole thing and breaking it into groups. How many groups? 3 groups. If I can break this into 3 groups, I can clearly see like this would go with one of the groups, this would go with another, this would go with another. So this side we're just dividing, breaking it into groups, like 3 groups. So it might take a second to make sure that we're dividing them equally. But there we go. 3 groups, right? Each one of those equal groups must be the same as one of those bags. It must be.
Has to be.
Has to be. There's no way around it. This must be the same as this bag. This the same as this bag. This is the same as that bag. It's gotta be. And clearly, in each group is 6 coins. So X, the bag, is worth six coins. Okay? So we have 2 different ways to take one step in an equation so far. We can add slash subtract.
Divide.
You can divide on
you
both sides. I use them all. Let me just put check marks because I don't have. My TA was supposed to fill them up, but he was not here today.
We should go for Shane.
Sean.
No, it doesn't matter.
Crucifix. Yeah. Come at me, bro.
Actually, I can do that while you guys are taking this.
Oh, please, no.
I can do that while you're taking this. Okay. All right, let's try and wrap our heads around this. Around this idea. Okay. Grab a bag here. And I will turn this back on. Got a bag. There. Hold on, don't get too excited. Now, what I'm going to do is. So half a bag is worth 6 coins. Now how many bags do I want to know the value of?
One
whole bag. Now, hold on just a second. So that we can see it in equation form. Our end goal here is to get one whole x on one side by itself.
Yeah.
Okay, so now.
A whole bag would be 12.
A whole bag would have to be 12. Exactly half of the bag is worth 6. Then 2 of those halves would have to be what a whole bag is worth, right? So if I erase all of that stuff, now I have a whole bag. What have I done to the left side? Yes, it is heavier now, and I have to balance it out, but I have to kind of figure out how to balance it out. Like, what? By how much have I made it heavier? See?
You've made it 6 points heavier?
2 times.
I'm looking for twice as heavy.
I'm sorry.
Right? It's twice. I have half a bag, I don't want to make it twice as heavy on that side so that I know how much one whole bag is worth. So, if I double this side, I'll have to double this. I wish you know what I can do. Just go like this, and I can duplicate it. Just double. Double that side. What does that look like symbolically? When I have half of an x, half times x, right? Half times something is half that thing. Is that thing divided by 2? That was equal to 6. And keep in mind what we're trying to do here. We're trying to get one whole x by itself. We're trying to get 1 times an x. 1 times a bag, right? So how do we cancel out that 1/2?
Yeah, divide 0.5 by 6. And times. Now you multiply it. Yeah.
Multiply by 2 over 1. all cancels out. You get 1x. You have to multiply this side by 2 as well. So you get one bag is worth 12. Well, here's something that would be hard to do physically. I can only really reasonably do it symbolically. Okay? I can show you half a bag, I can show you maybe a third of a bag, I can show you one and a half bags, but beyond that, like fractions of bags would be hard to visualize. So we have to just symbolically represent things like that. So what if I gave you something like 5/4 bag. Is that more than one bag, or
that
more than one X,
one.
Or less than one X?
More.
It's an X and a fourth more than an X, and a fourth of an X more. Okay, so 5/4 X equals, let's say, 25. Figure out what one whole X by itself is equal to. Now, symbolically, it just becomes kind of a little game of how do I get this guy in front to be just the number one? How do I cancel out that 5/4 so I'm left with a 1x? And do what with it? And multiply? Does that work? If I multiply a fraction by its reciprocal, I'll get 20 over 20. Or the 5s will cancel, the 4s will cancel. But what do I have to do on the other side? What did I just do? I just made this side actually lighter. Right? 4/5 of something is less than it was. So I made this side lighter, I need to make this side lighter, I need to do the same thing to this side, I need to do what to this side? Times it by the exact same thing, 4/5. Exact same thing. This 5 will cancel this 25, then goes with 5 times 4 is 20. X is 5/4 x is equal to 25. Multiply by 4/5 on both sides. How do I mean y to get 1 times x instead of 2 times x or 3 times x? The way that we know what x is worth is to know what 1 times x. So we get that number for it to be a 1. 1x equals 20. And that's what we wanted to know. Okay. So we have add, subtract, divide, multiply on both sides. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay. How could it make more sense?
Confused by what? Never mind.
No, it's okay. What are you confused by?
No, I'm really. Yeah, it makes sense. I'm sorry.
Okay. Well, let's look at subtracting from both sides. Let's go back to an example of subtracting on both sides. Slowly. Oh, this is going to crash. Is that what it is?
Excuse me, drawing. Excuse me.
Okay, let's see if this is work. All right, so this is level. Here on this side, we have see this container here? It's like our mystery bag. X. There's three little coins here. There's three little coins there. There's 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 on this side. Well, I just want to know what one X is worth. If I kind of hold it down here, you can see. X and 3 over there, there's 9 over here.
What is that white thing? It looks like a marshmallow.
It's just 5 of these taped together.
Oh, it looks like a marshmallow.
Okay, so if I want to know what 1X is worth, what do I do? Yeah? How many? There's 3 on this side. I'll take away these 3 so that only an X is left. Well, that throws everything out of balance.
And you take 3 away. That's
it's worth 6. Now, this container weighs 1. So what should be inside?
1.
Should be 5. Plus this 1. This weighs as much as 1 of these. Right? So the whole thing is 6. So what do we do?
Oh geez.
Like algebraically, what do we do on both sides?
Minus.
You subtracted 3 from both sides. We're subtracting by the same thing on both sides. Find the computer. Dividing on both sides. There's 2 containers on this side. There's 12 coins on this side. So what do we need to do to both sides?
You could just divide by 2.
Divide by 2, right? Look at half of this versus half of this, because half of this is the next, half of this must be the same x. So here, half of 12 is 6. And I take away half of that. So adding both sides, subtracting from both sides, dividing on both sides, are all fairly simple operations you need to do to both sides. Okay? So if there's 2 x's and 6 on this side, yes, let's say 3x and 12 on this side, and there's a 27 on that side. Well, just imagine this, there's 3 bags and 12 coins on this side, 27 coins on the other side. I want to get one of the just one bag by itself on one side.
How are we going to get this? 10. 10. 10. No, 5 minutes. Oh, wait, no, 10 minutes. 5 minutes.
Sorry.
No, 5.
So, we want to know the value of one bag, right? So, we want to get all of the clear house. Just get all that stuff that is cluttering the side with the bag on it away so that we can know what one bag is.
You're gonna take 12 away from both sides.
Let's get rid of those 12, which we're gonna take 12 away from this side too. 3x equals 15.
Yeah.
Divide by 3 on both sides. So this is an example of a two-step equation. That's where we are right now, two-step equations. Let's just do one more. About 5/3 x plus 4 equals 19.
You subtract 4.
Let's get rid of that 4. Let's take 4 away from the side. 5/3 x equals 15.
Oh. Then you multiply by the reciprocal.
Multiply by the reciprocal. Now those cancel each other out. 15 cancels with 5, leaving you 3. Does 3 times 3?
It
does not.
That is like, that's so easy. I love it.
I guess maybe I didn't exactly lie, but I did think of one more thing. Hold on. We do have more time. But we shouldn't use all of it. How about if 3.7x plus 4.9 equals 12.6? I don't want to try and draw a picture of this and represent it on a scale or something, because it's either difficult to do or just kind of nonsense to do, but...
Minus 4.9 to...
Okay, we get rid of these 4.9 coins. We'll subtract 4.9 coins from this side. Okay, let's see, 8.7? Is it 7.7?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. And then what?
You divide by...
We would still divide by... Like, we still want to get 1 times x, right? To get 1 times x, we'll divide 3.7 by 3.7 to get 1x, right? Cancel that. 3.7 divides 3.7. So we'll divide this by 3.7. Whatever 7.7 divided by 3.7 is. That's what x is. What is it? You got your calculator, right? 7.7 divided by 3.7?
Mm-hmm.